In this video, we're going to look at getting a Commodore 64's output working on a common HDMI monitor. Using an S-Video cable and an inexpensive S-Video to HDMI adapter, we'll see if we can get this machine working again. In the last video, we got a power supply put together in preparation for my first Commodore 64 repair in over 25 years. I connected the Commodore 64 to our TV and it worked, but with some issues. Today I'm making an S-Video cable for use with this inexpensive HDMI converter so that I can connect it to a modern monitor and use it on my workbench. Once I get the computer and disk drive working, I'm going to try to get this RPG game I was creating in the early 80s up and running. But first I need to be able to work on it at my bench, so let's get to it. To build an S-Video cable, you'll need a few components. You'll need a two-channel RCA cable. In my case, I had a three-channel one that came with the S-Video to HDMI converter, but it was easy to remove one strand. You'll also need a standard S-Video male-to-male cable, which, in my case, also came with the HDMI converter. Finally, you'll need a male 8-pin DIN connector and a 330-ohm resistor. If you want to use HDMI, then you'll need an HDMI converter with the S-Video inputs. The 8-pin DIN used on the Commodore 64 video port is a bit unusual. A standard DIN connector, like this one, has the outer pins in a semicircle. The Commodore 64 video port has them in a U-shape, as seen in this diagram. Fortunately, when you examine the pinouts on the port, you can see that the two offending pins are unused, so I was able to simply snip them off. Since we only need one end of the S-Video and RCA cables, we can cut them in the center and have enough to make two Commodore S-Video cables. Finally, I just removed about half an inch of the outer sheath on each cable and stripped the ends of the conductor wires. Before doing any soldering, I'll add some short pieces of heat shrink tubing to the cables so I can tie them together neatly when I'm finished. This is also the time to add the DIN connector hood. Next, I checked the wire connections for the S-Video cable, just as I did for the power supply. I will include a link to a blog post in the description below that includes this cheat sheet to use yourself. After tinning the chrominance wire and the short lead on the 330-ohm resistor, I soldered them together. The resistor is there because the Commodore 64 chrominance signal is a little too strong for some TVs, so the resistor dampens the signal a bit to reduce noise. Since the Commodore 64 has only one ground connection, I will solder both the chrominance and luminance grounds together. I will also solder the left and right audio wires together since Commodore 64 only outputs a mono audio signal. One thing that Ilka mentions in his blog post is that a DIN connector fits well in the solder braid package, and indeed it does fit, but was a bit loose and kept moving around, so I added a little blue tack to hold it in place. Keep in mind that when you're looking at the back side of the DIN connector, the pin numbers are the same as the front side of the socket on the computer, but are reversed when looking at the pin side of the connector. When soldering the resistor to pin 6, try to keep the length consistent with the other wires. I thought I had it pretty good here, but it was long by about a millimeter, and that made things more difficult later. Finally, the luminance wire goes to pin 1, and the video grounds goes to pin 2 and 5, which have been bridged with solder. That blue tack was a bad idea. It melted all over the DIN connector pins, and I spent the next half hour cleaning it off. This video is largely based on a blog post by Ilka Hirstad, which I will link below. As always, I then double-checked everything for shorts and continuity. next issue I ran into was the pins on the cheap DIN connector had shifted and had to be realigned. The plastic had melted enough for the pins to move a bit. I used a small screwdriver to adjust their positions until the connector worked smoothly. The video converter I'm using will take a composite or S-video signal and output them as HDMI. After connecting the new cable to the converter and the converter to my monitor, I powered everything up for a test. Initially, the output looked horrible, but once I switched the converter from 480p to 1080p, it looked much better. I can now button things up by tightening the heat shrink tubing for a cleaner cable appearance. And there you have it. One subtle subliminal-ish message later and we're up and running. If you like this video and want to see more like it, hit subscribe. And here's another video you might like.